Joining me right now is presidential candidate Carly Fiorina. It has been a very interesting couple of weeks, of course. Mrs. Fiorina, it's always good to speak with you. Welcome to the program.
Thank you so much, Dana. And please, Carly's okay.
Oh, well, I will call you Carly, and I will tell everyone I'm on a first-name basis with you now.
There you go.
So this is, obviously, it has been nothing short of a horrific week, and I know that you have been discussing particularly one of the most disappointing headlines that we have seen this week, and really a terrifying one, was the president's deal on, well, deal, I use in air quotes, with Iran. And I think one of the things that everyone's looking at, everyone, of course, is watching the Republican Congress to see what's going to happen. Are they going to have enough muscle to defeat this deal? And if they don't, and if they don't have enough to override a veto, that of course would prove to be a really big issue that you, if you win this race, or whomever gets into the White House, is going to have to deal with in 2016. How would you fix that situation? How would you even go about it?
Yeah, well, it's a great question, and I think it's important for your listeners to understand that even if Congress defeats this deal, which I earnestly hope they will, but even if they defeat it, the rest of the world has moved on. It will be very difficult to, it's not impossible, to stop the Europeans, the Russians, and the Chinese from moving ahead with this deal. They don't have any similar opportunities to stop it. They signed up. And each of those entities, the Europeans, the Chinese, and the Russians, have a huge self-interest in opening up the economy of Iran. So we are going to be left with, I believe, even if Congress defeats this deal, the next president of the United States will face a very important moment. I've been very clear about what I would do. I would make two phone calls immediately day one. The first would be to Bibi Netanyahu, Prime Minister of Israel, to reassure him that we will stand with the state of Israel. The second would be to the Supreme Leader of Iran. He might not take the phone call, but the message is this: until you permit anytime, anywhere, without prior notice, inspections of every nuclear facility and every military facility, we will cut off your access to the SWIFT system, which allows any country to process payments through the global financial system. We don't need anyone's permission to do it. We don't need anyone's collaboration to do it. And if Iran cannot move money around the global financial system, they will have a great deal of difficulty financing their proxies, who will continue to sow conflict and dissent in the Middle East. It will have to be done, and I would do it.
Yeah, well, and that reassuring with Israel as well, I think, is supremely important, because they feel betrayed. And not only do they feel betrayed, but we see these other Arab nations looking to see if the United States treats their ally like this. I mean, this is going to kickstart,
exactly,
I'm afraid, is going to be a nuclear arms race.
Well, and in fact, our other Arab allies, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Jordan, Egypt, the Emiratis, the Bahrainis, the Kurds, all of these nations and peoples, whether they agree with Israel or not, exactly to your point, Dana, they watch how we are treating Israel, and they conclude, you know what? Our friendship with the United States doesn't mean very much. And so while President Obama grandly declares that this deal will stop a Middle East arms race, in fact, this deal begins a Middle East arms race.
Very much so. I fear what it's going to mean for the next generation, my kids' generation, which is why I tell folks 2016 is so unbelievably important. Moving from Iran and looking a little bit more domestically, this video surfaced 2 days ago. Planned Parenthood's medical doctor, Dr. Deborah Nucatola, on video discussing the potential felony sale of body parts of aborted babies, and just the lack of humanity that she had during this discussion. Now, I know that Congress has said that they're going to instigate an investigation. Louisiana and Texas have both said they're going to also conduct their own investigations. Should Planned Parenthood be defunded?
Absolutely, yes. You know, this is so depraved. Never mind the hypocrisy of saying, those unborn children who are aborted are not lives, and yet the organs that they have are advanced enough to save another baby's life. I mean, never mind the intellectual hypocrisy of that. But honestly, the moral depravity of people who will say, oh, no, no, this is just about medical research. Honestly, Dana, as horrifying as that video is, My own view is that it is a symptom of a cultural decline that really is quite shocking. Even if a woman out there is pro-choice, even if a woman has had an abortion herself, I don't see how anyone looks at this video and concludes anything other than this is depraved.
Yeah, depraved, and it's, oh my goodness. And to think that this, because they receive millions of dollars of taxpayer money every single year, and then, of course, they donate to Democrat candidates. So it's like they get public money that really goes towards this horrendous practice, and as well as supporting Democrat, like, well, Democrat presidential candidates as well.
That's right. That's right. And they immediately, you know, the New York Times buried this story on, I don't know, A16 or something, spent most of the story letting Planned Parenthood say, well, it's only a small percentage of what we do, and trying to lift themselves up. Oh, we want to help others promote medical research and save other lives.
Right.
Wow. It's just, it almost leaves you speechless. It's so unbelievable.
Yeah. Last quick question for you, because I know you're busy traveling, and you and I are actually sitting down for my show on the Blaze towards the,
I know. I'm so excited.
Tomorrow. Yeah, you'll be in Dallas. It'll be good to have you in Dallas. You had answered a question about Donald Trump and the headlines surrounding illegal entry. John McCain came out today saying, well, Donald Trump fired up all the crazies. But when I hear, I mean, those were his exact words. When I hear, though, people who call into the program, it's not so much that they're looking, it doesn't sound like they're looking at Trump as the candidate. They're focusing on the force and fury of his message. And you had identified, you know, something's resonating here.
Well, exactly. You know, look, people are sick of the professional political class. 80% of people in this country now think we have a professional political class of both parties that cares more about it, the preservation of its own position and power, than anything else. So let's just ask a question. How long has the border been insecure? 25 years? How long has the legal immigration system been broken? 25 years? How long have we have sanctuary cities? 15 years? Now that the headlines have gone to this point, you know, you're going to have people in Congress stand up and give speeches, and people are going to pass laws, and, you know, politicians are going to say a bunch of stuff, but the truth is this problem has been around for decades. And so people, of course, are angry because they're sick of talk and they want results and action. I agree with them. It's why I'm running.
Absolutely. Carly Fiorina, candidate for the White House 2016. Always good to speak with you. Thanks for stopping by and talking with our audience today. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Dana. See you tomorrow.
Of course.